Today we're talking wildlife photography and can you do wildlife photography on a kit lens, on a mid-range full frame body, on a crop sensor body? The answer is yes. And today we're gonna show you guys how I got some of these shots that you saw here in the intro. There'll be some more at the end of this video. Now, wildlife photography is one of the most challenging photography environments that you can be in, subjects to shoot. This isn't a wedding. This isn't a studio shoot. Now, those have their own challenges, but an eagle is not gonna listen to you to pose or frame a shot, and it's definitely not gonna slow down for you. But wildlife in general, moose, boars, bears, please, if you're watching this video, this is the disclaimer. It is called wildlife because it's wild and dangerous. So be respectful whenever you go out to shoot animals, wildlife, you're in the wilderness, and do take care of yourself because these are living things that are doing their thing too. Wildlife gear especially can be super intimidating. Put the challenges of shooting the subjects aside. If you see someone who actually knows what they're doing as far as wildlife shooting goes, they probably look something like this. Shout out to Stephen Tam, AKA Shot Bank Photos. If you guys watched the vlogging with the Pixel 4A video I put out a couple weeks ago, this was the guy who was in the kayak taking those shots while I was vlogging on the shoreline. Just look at that massive lens that he has. I mean, that thing is, dude, it's like, this is what I think about when I think about wildlife photography. That lens even has camo on it. Like, come on, come on. Now for the rest of us mere mortals, maybe all we have is a full frame mirrorless camera with a kit lens or a crop sensor camera. I think it's still worth it to get out there and try to take on this sort of challenging environment, because I know I learned a lot over the last few weeks going out and shooting these eagles with some of my friends and had a great time. So here's some tips shooting wildlife photography with the kit lens. First up, when you go out to shoot wildlife, you need to know your gear. This is not a first time out kind of event that you want to do with your camera. You should know how your body and your lens work together. That means understanding aperture, ISO, focal length, shutter speed, your focus and how you focus, and also your drive settings. If you're unable to tune these settings on the fly quickly, it can be very frustrating to shoot. One of the first settings you're gonna wanna dial in is your shutter speed. Now, anything fast action, you wanna make sure you have a shutter speed that is somewhere probably between 250 and 320, maybe even higher depending on how you're trying to get that shot. I know for me, I was starting out at about 125 and that just wasn't fast enough to get these birds in focus. A lot of times I could get the body in focus, but the wings were still coming out completely blurred out, or I was trying to get shots of these birds coming in over the water and the water would be completely blurred out, where it's like, oh, if I just pulled back that shutter speed even tighter, I could have gotten a shot that was a lot cooler. I could have had that banger, you know, that banger shot. To give yourself the best opportunity to get that subject in shot, you're gonna wanna use a smaller aperture, which is a higher number in your f-stop range. So something like a 5.6 to 11 is gonna be usually where you wanna play. That's usually where I wanna play around when I'm outdoors shooting. Now that you have a faster shutter speed and a tighter aperture, that means less light is going to be getting into your camera. Still, it's important though to control that light by not bumping or lowering your ISO, depending on how low your ISO can go. One of the big challenges you can have shooting wildlife out in the open, where you have the sun and clouds, like we had here out on the lake shooting, every day was cloudy. Sometimes we get the sun peeking through for only 5-10 minutes, and if you couldn't quickly change how much light was coming into that already really tightly tuned aperture, you would lose the shot. It'd get totally blown out. Autofocus wouldn't even work because these birds would just be so blown out against the sky. That's where a V&D comes in. I shot every single one of these sessions using the Polar Pro V&D 2-5, and I constantly found myself switching back and forth between the 2-stop to the 5-stop and everywhere in between as the clouds shifted throughout the day. What that did is that gave me a really easy way to keep my camera up to my face, keep getting those shots, while just twisting the V&D to control the light as the clouds were moving and sort of moving the light from the sun along with it. And the final recommendation I'd have for you is to understand how to fire your drive settings on your camera. This is, are you firing single shot? Are you gonna fire a burst? Are you gonna fire continuous? All of these have their pluses and minuses. When you're shooting wildlife photography, I would recommend trying to use a healthy dose of all three. I found sometimes I could get a really good shot with a single shot, with just a single hit of the shutter, but that actually decreased my hit rate to where maybe I would only get one really good shot out of like 50 or 100 shots. Versus shooting continuous, that allowed me to get more shots, but then I'm draining batteries faster, I'm filling up cards faster, and I don't wanna be out in the field going through 100, 200 photos of one sequence of that bird moving and having to try to figure out which one's the one I'm gonna have to delete. Even if I have backup cards, even if I have backup batteries, I don't wanna be fiddling with those and changing them out. So it is a balance, and you wanna make sure that you understand how you can move between those drive settings to best optimize your card and your battery on your camera. And just a little more insight before I go, most of these were taken at 105 millimeters on the kit lens, so I was thrown all the way out. And even still, I had a crop in post just to try to frame up my subject. This is where the EOS R's 30 megapixel sensor does wonders here, that I can take that particular shot, zoom in, crop in, reframe, and still get something that's really usable even out at 105 millimeters, where I probably, if I could, this is actually making me realize I really want the Canon 70 to 200, but now I know why. Is because I want that extra focal range to go beyond 105, and I now really know what 105 can get me out of the kit lens, and it's still really usable. It's still really great for creating content. The stuff that I've posted on Instagram has gotten a lot of great feedback, and I'm stoked to post more of it. But even for less money, I'll show you guys here, like I said at the beginning of the video, both Lindsay and Mish came out on different shooting sessions. They were shooting both with Canon Rebels, Lindsay with the T2i, Mish with the T7i, and they were sharing that EFS 18 to 200. And that was a great example of what you can get going all the way out to 200, which I think on a crop sensor is, I think, even almost like 300 millimeter. And that's even less money than the Canon EOS R body alone. I'll throw up a few of those photos here to finish off this video. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Stephen Foster. Subscribe to this channel if you aren't already. I would be honored if you would. Please be kind, both in life and in the comments below. Like this video if you're a fan of freedom and birds that have brand deals in the USA and Mexico. And we'll do it again soon.